Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Lydia. I'm a first-year student at Fuqua, and I'm super honored to introduce our afternoon keynote speaker, Audrey Zibelman. Audrey is an experienced energy industry executive who has led efforts to decarbonize the power industry as an entrepreneur, CEO, and government leader. She is a member of President Biden's National Infrastructure Advisory Council and holds several advisory positions in companies like X, Alphabet's Moonshot Factory. Audrey was previously general manager of Tapestry, X's Moonshot for the electric grid, where she led projects' efforts to develop highly accurate digital models of the grid. The conversation will be moderated by Julian Spector. Julian is a Duke alum and senior reporter at Canary Media, where he reports on the rise of clean energy. Let's give both of them a warm welcome.
All right, well, thank you all for being here. How are you feeling in Durham today? We got a little energy? Yeah, we're not asleep after lunch. We have a good energy level at the energy conference. Okay, that's great. So this is gonna be a fun conversation. I always like to do like a very brief introduction to just get into things on these panels, but Audrey's career is too jam-packed with exciting roles to allow for that. So in addition to the things that were just mentioned in that intro, Audrey did some time in the entrepreneurship world as a founder of Viridity, which was doing energy storage and demand response kind of back before it was cool, we might say, you know, early mover in that space. Spent some time at PJM, which is one of the major, you know, grid operators in the mid-Atlantic states. Was the lead regulator of New York's utility sector at the New York Public Service Commission, went to Australia, oversaw Australia's grid operator, then went to, you know, Google, and now is advising on startups like Span and EOS Energy, as well as Rocky Mountain Institute, which is kind of near and dear to my heart because they helped us launch Canary Media, in fact. So we're gonna be delving into what Audrey learned, doing all those different roles, tackling all those challenges around the world over the years, and try to pull out some advice for you all who are kind of getting into the job force and, you know, looking at careers in this space. And then we'll get to questions at the end. So I think to kick it off, you know, you've been really hands-on working with some of the most transformative grid systems in the world. Do you have a favorite grid? What's the best grid?
Favorite.
Yeah, what's?
No.
No, they're not children, so you can pick a favorite.
They're all the grids. I went to Australia because I was fascinated about what was going on there, and continue to be fascinated by them, because I think it's one of these things that people, you know, in the US, we tend to be a little over-focused on the US. In Australia, if you think about the country, it's geographically the same size as the lower 48, but there's only 26 million people, and there were 20 million people when Peter and I were in New York. And, so that's a lot of people spread out over, not a lot of people spread out over a really big region. But what happened in Australia was that even though the policy was fairly bad for a long time, they, like the US, the states, a lot of the states were wanted to move forward with renewables. The federal policy was hopeless because of the fact that Australia is, for a long time, has been one of the major exporters of coal and LNG worldwide. So getting out of fossil was a bit difficult for them from a whole GDP standpoint. But the fact of the matter is, it's one of the best places in the world for solar and wind. Mm. One of the advantages of not having a lot of people is you have a lot of space. And one of the reasons they don't have a lot of space is it's a very hot, dry climate. And so as a result, what we saw, when I saw it was over the 4 years, with this rapid transition of where people started thinking about, well, I want to put solar in my roof because it's the right, it's not, no longer because it's the right thing to do for the environment, it was just the right thing to do for me. So it stopped being an identity issue and started to be just like, I have a car, I have a dishwasher, I have solar on my roof, no big deal, doesn't tell you how I vote. So now everyone in, you know, basically one out of three Australians have solar on their roof. And so we quickly, over the course of 4 years, went from 100,000 installations to several million, wow. meaning that there are parts of Australia today where 100% of their energy is being provided by rooftop solar during parts of the day.
And that's comparable huge. To how many rooftop solar is in the U.S., right?
They're the fastest growing economy for that. And then the other thing that happened is that they thought I ran the grid, and so we were doing plans for what happens when the coal retires. Well, it all moved forward a decade because the solar started eating the lunch of coal and was already doing it. But the fact of the matter is that the coal plants could no longer economically operate. So very quickly, we're seeing this transition, and good for them. Rather than resisting it, everyone started to lean into it and say, okay, it's happening. Let's make it happen in the most efficient way.
Yeah.
So I feel like it's a story that people should spend a lot more time looking at how Australia, which is a fairly significant economy, highly industrialized, is actually taking steps to really transform much faster than most economies across the world.
Right. Okay. So you don't have a favorite grid, but you did talk a lot about Australia.
I like it because what they do is they're demonstrating. When everyone here says, "Oh, it's going to be hard. Oh, it can't happen. Oh, we're going to have these problems," I could say, "Well, hang on. They're already doing it." So
they're already. I love that because I think that's the best way to refute the doubt is, you know, if someone tells you this can't possibly be done, and you're like, "No, look, it already happened. I could show you.
It's happening. Out there. The lights are still on."
The lights are still on, right? It just keeps going. I mean, I was just writing about, I do a lot of energy storage coverage for Canary Media. There's this announcement of the biggest battery in the world is going to be this 850 megawatt, just enormous battery in New South Wales. And it's intended to help with the retirement of this really massive coal plant, the biggest coal plant in the country that's like 2,800 megawatts. So like now this battery is still nowhere near the size of that coal plant that's shutting down in a few years.
This is an interesting thing. Okay, so when I was in Australia, I worked for the National Grid, which was half owned by the government and half owned by private industry. Mm. And we had a massive issue around how we're going to make this transformation. So I was part of a small group that was advising the prime minister on, who was liberal, so we would call him Republican, government, on how to make this happen. He had a right wing of his party who ousted him. So I got to have the wonderful thing as an American to help oust an Australian prime minister, which I can't vote for. But as a result, one of the things that happened is you started to see the conservative government started leaning in towards the energy transition. Mm. And so one of the hopes I have, frankly, the other piece that is in New South Wales is run by what we would call Republican government. Mm. We would call them small R Republicans, not big R, they're not Trumpian Republicans. I'm not getting into politics here.
No,
but they're mid-range Republicans. But the point is they see it as an economic growth vehicle, right? And that's what I'm really hoping with the U.S. is that we can start realizing with the energy transition, it's no longer a sort of only some people should care about it. There's a huge, as you were talking about earlier, there's a huge amount of job growth, huge amount of economic wealth. There's a huge amount of advantage to economies who will move faster. Mm-hmm. That people really in Europe, even despite the Ukraine war, sort of recognized for a long time. And I think we people in the US, hopefully now it's gonna start dawning on people that actually this is the way to create economic stability.
And what did you do while you were in Australia to accelerate that? Like what levers did you have from the grid operator side to kind of create the conditions for this to happen?
Well, we did a couple things. One is we really focused on the fact that this is happening, right? And so we need the technology to make it happen and make it happen as efficiently as possible. So one area we really focused on is what's it going to take to run power systems that are totally dependent on renewables and storage and hydro. Australia banned nuclear in the 70s. Mm. And I, you know, it's unclear whether they're going to let it back in. So it was clear that it wasn't going to be fossil. Mm. We needed to start looking at it. So we, as a grid operator, I started looking at the information technologies that I was going to need to be able to run a power system that was totally dependent on renewables. That was one area. Secondly was storage. Third was to, and this is a little bit of what we did in New York too, was to really start looking at the policies and how to drive efficiency through the system. So, and this was a major concern of mine when I was the chief regulator in New York, continued to be a concern in Australia, is that half the grid, right, is people, consumption. Mm. So driving to the point where we make load much more flexible and able to participate on the system not only was an advantage as it, it helped make the grid more resilient, because while I was there, we had bushfires. And so being able to make sure that people had electricity in the middle of a bushfire was fairly important, because they're already feeling vulnerable. But the other piece is it made the entire system more efficient. And I think what we'll find in the energy transition is that driving towards efficiency, because there's so much capital we have to spend making the system more resilient, more efficient, more dependable at the edge of the system through electrification, will be very important. So I was involved in a lot of policy around how to create the two-way system that we can use. Rather than rooftop solar being a threat, we can get to 100% penetration using a combination of thermal storage, hot water heaters, electric vehicles, and make that portion of the grid much more active. So that is at the renewable space, you can have both load balancing generation and generation balancing load. And so they're moving very quickly.
Because you did say some parts are already
at 100%. So our
and to be clear, that was something a lot of people said could never be done, that would blow up the grid. And it's already a regular thing there.
Yeah. Ah.
And okay, and then on the storage side, weren't you there when Elon Musk famously bet that he would deliver the world's biggest battery in 100 days? And in fact, that was one of his promises he did deliver on.
Yeah, so we were, yeah.
What was that like? You were there, this huge battery shows up in 100 days? What?
Yeah, this is actually, so I arrived in Australia in March of 2017. They had had, of course, you know, we're going into the spring in Australia, so it was summer.
Yeah.
They had had a major outage in South Australia, one of the big states, that as a result of a storm earlier in the year. And I got off the plane, and there was on the TV was the governor of South Australia and the head of the treasurer of the U.S. almost in a fight, talking about the role of renewables. And that was like my entry to the Australia, and I thought, well, this is really weird. But the argument was that the federal minister was challenging the state governor and saying, you're just being, you know, crazy. Mm. You're leaning into renewables, it's not working. He says, yes, it will. And then that was that point that Elon Musk had a bet with Mike Cannon-Brookes, who's sort of a mini Elon Musk in Australia, but much nicer, working on whether or not they could do this. And so they had a Twitter fight. Musk said he would. They had a $100,000 bet or something like that. In any event, that's how it happened. And then I was at AEMO, so we needed to make it happen. So we did it, and it was to. And what happened is that what we discovered is rather than wind and solar being a problem, we used the battery to help provide basically firm it at the edge of the system. And that was the beginning of where storage started to go in Australia. But it was, I think what it demonstrated to me is, you know, in this industry is, and it's again and again a learning, which is that it's never going to be technology that's going to be the challenge. And we saw this when we were in, we did the regulatory reform in New York. It's you know, it is the system of systems problem. The physical system of the grid has challenges associated with renewables. You know, we have things like, for example, our grid has never been highly correlated. Our risk was uncorrelated because you didn't expect every coal plant to fail simultaneously. Once you depend on renewables, whether climate, real-time climate conditions will affect your demand and supply in a region. So you have to deal with a whole different risk profile for the grid where you're much more dependent on climatic conditions than you ever were before. It's those types of things that are challenging but are solvable once you recognize that's an issue to be solved. What is more challenging are the financial systems, the regulatory systems, the political system. So I think one of the things that's fascinating to me around where we are in this sort of route to decarbonization, when I started in the industry in the late 80s and then through the 90s, the big thing were wind and solar, could it really work, et cetera, and I was at a utility.
We get the 20% of
it. Yeah, right, and you know, 15%. It's gonna be a problem.
Yeah.
Now we've sort of, in fact, you know, people are saying, well, doing wind farms and solar farms is not even that much interesting anymore. It's nothing really unique, it's just project management, we could do that. But it's the next layer of complexity that we're headed to is like, well, really, how do you manage power systems that are highly correlated as we're electrifying? We were talking over lunch. Now we have to, the first time, we're coupling different industries. So do we optimize transport? We optimize power. How do we co-optimize these various things and adding in process, because these are things we didn't think about before. Mm. How do we, again, we're still there yet, not there yet. How do we re-regulate the utilities so that the process of electrification isn't a threat to them, but actually a way for them to make money? How do we get their investors to feel comfortable?
Yeah, well, actually, that's a good
so
jumping
all
off
these,
point.
So it's, we're at these different layers.
Yeah, a lot of layers. So you were in the thick of that in New York prior to Australia. At least from the outside, it feels like New York maybe doesn't quite move as quickly as Australia is on these rapid grid transformations. And there's a lot of stakeholders, there's a lot of politics, and you know, Con Ed, the main utility in New York City, has a lot of clout. And how do you think it's far enough along? Like, were you able to push the grid in a cleaner, more efficient direction as much as you wanted to there?
No. So we. I get to sort of a bit of context.
Yeah.
We, in New York was sort of, the governor of New York, Cuomo, he used to, on his stump speech, when he talked about the environment, would talk about the fact that his father was in office for, was it 12 years? And, you know, only had two or three major storms, and none of those major storms were as big as the storms he was seeing, and he had seen four or five. And we had a major blowout where a lot of people died on the highways in Western New York as a result of a snowstorm because there wasn't a good coordinated relief. This was before Sandy. Mm. When Sandy happened, it was truly frightening to people. I mean, you have people in Vertical City, right, without power for weeks, stays on end, and without heat. And so it's different, you know, if you're in a single home. Mm. You don't have power, it's inconvenient, you light candles, you play games, you know, you think about it and you say, oh, that was kind of a nice experience. Not that's not true if you're living on the 20th floor of a high rise. And so he was bound and determined not to let that happen. So the whole point in New York was, how do we make the system more resilient? How do we use distributed energy better? How do we change the utility structure? So rather than seeing distributed energy as a threat, because you know utilities make money off of deployment of capital, not necessarily capital efficiency.
Right.
How do we change that? And so for me, the challenge was, you know, and we think about when I, as an economic regulator, you know that people are always sort of managing towards incentives. And the incentive for utilities was always around deployment of capital because that's how they make money.
So if they go build a thing,
if they put in, they make a return, so they want to continue to grow.
It's a nice business. It's like 10% profit, kind of guaranteed.
Not guaranteed.
Not guaranteed.
Largely and
mostly guaranteed.
But the challenge is, of course, is you want to make sure it's efficient.
Yeah.
So what we did in New York, as we said, that we wanted utilities to actually make more money out of looking at non-wires alternatives and looking at putting in wires. And so our focus was sort of moving the incentive. And the goal then was to say, if we did that, then rather than thinking of rooftop solar batteries and things like that as a threat, they would see it as actually an advantage. Mm-hmm. So that was the move. But for anything like that, it has to be consistent. And then what happened in New York is people started refocusing on things like offshore wind, et cetera. So the utilities, you know, I think whilst the philosophy and the policies are still there, there's so much to be done that people stopped worrying about that and started worrying about just getting things built.
Yeah, well, there was a sort of, there's a period of time where reforming the energy vision was the big tagline, and that was the guiding principle. And I don't think it ever stopped, but they stopped saying that name. And so now it's kind of like the jargon has moved on, at least.
Right, different brand.
Yeah, different branding. So that was your time as a regulator. Let's talk about your startup days. Veridity, you were doing finding ways to make money on distributed energy in the markets that existed, more or less. Put some batteries on a train in Philadelphia and capture the energy and sell it to the grid and stuff like that. But can you talk about the journey there and what did you learn about trying to do a startup in a space where there's all these entrenched incumbents and really thick regulatory rules and was that a fun experience overall for you?
Yeah. So I guess there's a little bit of context there. I was the chief operating officer at PJM. And one of the things that we were running into was the fact that there was a lot of congestion on the transmission system, and we knew we needed to build more transmission. This was in the early 2000s. And we had markets, but I saw that there was an opportunity to create demand response markets that were much richer than the ones that were there, which were just more about peak shaving. So we had a program at PJM to see that we could create a form of revenue for everything that happened on the consumption side as for generators. So we created markets for reserves and actually also advocated for demand to get into the day-ahead markets, which is as well as the capacity markets for PJM, which are highly lucrative markets. But I also saw that there wasn't a lot of participation. Mm. And part of it was that the demand was still much at the very early stages of peak shaving, of Enernoc, of just, you know, if it hits a hot day, we take the load off. And I was very interested to see if we can get loaded into more of the market. So I formed Viridity to look at whether or not we could apply load optimization, including of assets. And that was sort of the basis of Viridity. What I've learned there, I could probably, you know, was as someone who's always been in the energy sector trying to do a startup, I made every mistake a rookie could make on how you start a company, so I can happy to tell everyone all, you know.
Could you name a few? I mean, that might be useful there might be some startups that could avoid some mistakes.
I could name the top few.
Yeah.
Find the right investors.
Sorry?
Make sure you have right investors. Don't believe them when they tell you they're the right investor. Do your due diligence. Make sure you have enough capital. I think this is what I see generally is people are just highly undercapitalized, and you've got to do that. Maintain your ownership structure. I think, you know, making sure you maintain the majority. Those are three that I would think about. And then the other piece was this, you know, I was always in the industry, kind of had a chance to try to think about how to look around corners and think about what are the next things. It's been a lot of fun. The issue with startups is you can't be that so far ahead that it's too hard to make change. So trying to time what you're doing in such a way that it's differentiated, but not so differentiated.
Hmm.
I think we were about a decade early in Viridity.
Gotcha. So, and that's tough because if you hadn't been doing that and no one else was breaking that market open, maybe there wouldn't be a market 10 years later. But
yeah.
You know, so someone has to take the plunge, but
right.
Then you might be...
And it's not a failure. It's never a failure. That's the last thing is you can't fail. As long as you're learning, you're not failing.
Yeah, okay. I guess speaking of learning and failing and lessons, can you talk, you know, throughout your career, how have you decided when, you know, it's time to move on from one role? Like, you've had so many interesting roles, but, like, New York's grid is still reforming, Australia's grid is still reforming, you know, you've made choices to kind of like move on to the next thing. So like, how do you do that? And then how do you pick which challenge is it so exciting that that you want to go and do it?
Yeah. So when I started in the power industry, it was a little bit sideways. I was hired by the Minnesota Attorney General's office. I'm an attorney by training, to do civil rights litigation for the state of Minnesota. And there just wasn't that much civil rights litigation. So they asked me to represent the state in utility matters. So I kind of went into it sideways, but fell in love with it because as a sector, there's very few sectors that have an impact where you can affect everybody like all day. So whether I was the chief regulator or working for a utility or working in basically as a startup, there's when energy goes well, right? Everyone's life is better. When it doesn't go well, it doesn't go well at all. So having that intersection of public policy, public good, and now environmental impact, I think there's very few industries that you could say that you're going to have that. And so what I've discovered in my career, and I would see there's probably some people around here who've had some experiences too, is don't plan it. Find something that you think is really interesting and do it. As long as you enjoy it, continue doing it. And when it stops being fun and someone offers you another opportunity that seems interesting, do that.
Okay.
I think that we, at least as a, for me, I haven't found many people who've planned their careers perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's the willingness to take some level of personal risk and doing something that you feel like you can learn something and where people seem to be doing the right thing that gives you the life satisfaction. And then as long as you're engaged, you'll do well. So you're not in this room because you don't know how to do well. So there you go.
Well, and that's interesting. So you're also not in, if you take that approach, you're not at risk of sort of being stuck in a job that no longer interests you or excites you. You know, you like, if you kind of keeping moving and finding the next exciting thing, you're not going to stagnate, which a lot of people do in their careers. You know?
Yeah, and so. I think that's right.
Yeah, cool. Well, gotcha. So then, a lot of people going off into the industry, or maybe they've done a little and now they're getting an advanced degree and going back. What do you think is like the most exciting place to be looking as a smart, you know, early career professional, you know, tackling the climate issue?
You know, I was thinking two things. I know where one is, you guys are, when I started, I don't want to sound long in the tooth, but I was in the 80s, you know, and 90s was a big thing about introducing competition in the generation sector. And that was like the big new thing. And I thought that was really interesting because, you know, before it was all integrated utilities, monopolies, and having competition was pretty cool. Since then, it's grown. But, you know, right now we're at a cusp where there's no question, right? We need to decarbonize. But we're getting into this next layer of huge complexity that I think you're entering industry at a time or your business lives at a time where it's really going to be the hard stuff. So nobody asked me, so I'm going to tell you, the book I'm reading now is How the World Really Works. It's actually one of the best books I've read on decarbonization because it's an honest assessment of not, we have to decarbonize. I mean, I love speed and scale, it's very nice, but it's really how hard it's going to be, and it's going to be really hard. Not only, because we're not at, like, should we do wind and solar and shut down fossil? It's how are we going to grow tomatoes without fertilizer? We need fertilizer. How are we going to produce fertilizer without fossil? Because it's, so we have to deal with green hydrogen, which is not going to be easy.
Yeah. Right?
Or cement or steel. So it's changing these massive industries. You know, we all know we have to electrify, right? But how are you going to electrify homes? You can't go one by one. That doesn't make sense. So how do we redo in this economy what we did in the 1930s when we electrified rural America? How do we create those kind of programs that are systemic? Because you can't, if you ask a utility, they can't have every third house. They're going to have to do it sort of in groupings. Well, we're not really good at that anymore, so how are we going to do that hard things? How are we going to provide access to the 800 million people in the world that don't have access? You hear what's going on in COP right now, and they're saying, well, wait a minute. Our carbon footprint is nothing to the first world industry. Now we have all this access to cheap gas and cheap fossils, and you're telling us in Africa that we can't use it because you guys have ruined the earth, and yet, so what do you, how are you going to make it affordable for us?
Mm-hmm.
And so I think, you know, you're like, you can't pick a place that it's not going to be interesting. Because we're getting into these really fascinating points.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't worry about it. I would find it, they're going to be looking for you. I would just try to find the job that seems most interesting.
In the lunchroom. People
and I would go for it, and when it stops being interesting, I'd go to the next thing.
Okay, I like that. Well, it's time for audience questions. So I will be looking at the Slido thing, and and we've got some upvotes happening, which makes my selection easier, so thank you. Okay, so Australia's energy transition was enabled by its democratic institutions. How can businesses in the US uphold democratic institutions instead of fighting policy? So that's interesting. I wonder if you have thoughts on that thing about democratic institutions in Australia and sort of what, you know, what was it, the electoral system that made it possible to do that transition? What institutions worked there and enabled change, and what should we learn from that over here?
So one of the things I did in Australia was I picked up a husband.
Oh, okay.
Who's Australian.
Yeah.
And I brought him back with me to the U.S., and he's shocked at how bad we are at democracy in the U.S. He's pretty well traveled. So the thing that was interesting to me in Australia is that they have mandatory voting.
Hmm.
So in every election, it's more than 90% of the people who vote, which I think is a really good idea. You don't get charged that much if you don't vote, but that moral aspect of getting a fine because you don't vote.
Mm.
So rather than preventing people from voting, they require people to vote. Mm. And it becomes a big celebratory event, which is a really nice thing. The other thing they do is force rank voting.
Mm.
And I think that's actually much better than the two-party system.
Okay.
And so it's interesting to me as an American, I always thought we had the best voting systems, and it was really shocking to actually know that we're not so good at this. So so I do think we need to take a relook at how we elect officials and how we think about voting in the US.
Yeah.
It is really, compared to the rest of the world, we're not very good. But the other thing that I think, it wasn't so much the democratic institutions that made a difference. It's a small country.
Hmm.
And what they realized is that so much, a big portion of their GDP was predicated on fossil exports.
Yeah.
That they needed to look at diversity because the future, you know, wasn't. And that, you know, so I think that there's that. And then the other thing that I think is different is, as a small country, but also probably a little bit of the background of Australia, they don't think of government as like the enemy, right? Mm. And so I was also, you know, sort of the cultural difference to me was during COVID, where the immediate reaction of the government was to start sending money to businesses so they could keep people on the payroll.
Mm.
And healthcare, universal healthcare, is seen as a right. It's not seen as like a problem. It's like, why wouldn't we do that? And I think the other piece of Australia is we need to do in the US, we need to kind of pull back together and realize why we're here.
Yeah.
And stop fighting each other, so.
This is making me think also, as you're looking at your career, if you can find a role in another country, that could be really fruitful for the comparative opportunities, learn how.
Yeah, I started my career as a Peace Corps volunteer living in Africa after college. And I do think for Americans, and I'm sure there's a lot of people who go to school here who came here to go to school, getting out and seeing how the rest of the world operates is a great part of your education. And if you haven't, you should, and I bet a lot of people here have already done that. But I do think working in a different country gives you a perspective that is hard to get if you don't do that.
Yeah. Well, let's we'll do sort of lightning round through a few more. There's a kind of cluster of questions asking about how the energy transition can bring the benefits to historically marginalized communities, and noting that in Australia there's a large indigenous population, and have they been brought into the energy transition?
One of the things that I really hope we have to deal with right now is around electrification. Mm. And what's going to be that one of the harder aspects of electrification is going to be electrifying in the urban core, and particularly electrification of low-income households. We still have the issue in terms of capital availability, but also in terms of it's older housing. So it's and then multi-unit, and there's lots of reasons. So I think this gets back to my earlier point. There needs to be a system-wide approach and different ways of approaching it. Mm. But the other aspect of that is we have it as a huge opportunity. I mean, one of the things that I saw coming out of COVID, and we all saw, is what a horror it was for inner city schools. And because of the fact that kids, particularly in low-income households, they really struggled during COVID. And we're seeing this in the reactions of the testing, right? So I like to think about, okay, this is a big problem, but what could we do about it? Well, one of the things we can do, and this is back to the question, we really need to invest in our schools. We need to really invest in our curriculums. There's a huge amount of workforce that needs to be created, not just smart people like you who are going to do financial engineering and things like that, but actually to retrofit our buildings. We need a lot of people to do a lot of different things. And we need to be thinking about the fact that in the US, and we've sort of decided that the trades, that somehow doing that was the wrong thing, you shouldn't do it, nobody should do it. Well, we need people to be able to do these things. So we have this opportunity.
Yeah, yeah, like if you want to
create a workforce that can help us,
you gotta have someone who can install it.
Right, build the infrastructure, which should be seen as really well-paying, really great career jobs. So I'm on the board of a company called Eos Energy. They're doing zinc bromide long-duration storage. Their factory is in Pittsburgh, in an area where Westinghouse was abandoned as part of the manufacturing core. And the people who are working in this factory, this is like the best paying job that this industry, that they've been able to gain, where it's a full paying job and a career. So we have to think about the green tech as not just, for folks doing financial engineering or new projects. There's this like this whole level of where we can create jobs, but also we can get communities engaged. And I think, one of the things we worked on when I was in New York, and I'll is the fact that we had a big problem with the internet divide, right? That internet literacy at low income was much lower, and we saw that during COVID where people didn't have access.
Yeah.
Right? Well, we can't let this happen with the green transition.
Yeah.
We should start with the EJ community and electrify that first, create the jobs and careers, and then move out, because that, starting with these hard problems will let everything else move faster.
There is a scenario where it's like the wealthy homes, single family homes that are owned, the homeowners can get their solar and get their electric cars and plug them in. And, if the market actors only go for those most profitable kind of wealthy customers, then you're not getting whole swaths of the population benefiting from it. Is that an area for policy to sort of like step in, because the market forces might not always drive people to spread the
benefits? Well, I think it's the market, one of the reasons we have green banks is to take a look at the fact that there are areas where capital won't go because the market's not there. Mm. And I definitely think that back to Australia, the role of government and the IRA will make a huge difference, is to be able to fill in these gaps and make sure that where the market won't go, and we can create these markets. So I think that's where we need system-based solutions, and we need to be thinking in those terms. But the other equity issue that goes with it, so one is, there's a huge amount of cost baked into your utility rates, not huge, but significant amount for low-income discounts. But there's other taxes and things like that. So when people put on rooftop solar and they go off the grid, there's less contribution to some of these social programs that is going into the distribution utility. But then the other piece is that the utility, because so much of its costs are fixed, more and more of those costs are being put into different stratas. And so unless we do this in a way that's equitable and we think forward on how we're going to do this, you're going to create this inequities. And then the other piece, which I think people get worried about in Europe in particular, is if we don't do this the right way, you know, people will now, they'll develop wind and solar projects where it's the best land. And if it's only, and we used to say this when we did deregulation, you know, the big dogs will eat first. If it's only the large companies that are going to do their PPAs and renew, then the next spade will go into the properties that are harder. And so the costs will be higher. So we've got to be able to think about these things in such a way so we don't put ourselves in a position where, yes, some people will have Teslas in their home and they'll be electrified and it'll be wonderful, and other people will be paying for a critical grid that's more and more expensive. And so thinking about equity in a broad way, beyond access, which we need to provide to the world, is going to be, I think, one of those layers of problems that I think people should definitely be thinking about how to work.
Yeah, and maybe some of you could be thinking about in your jobs and stuff. But and a kind of related question I think is fun is, what was the greatest inefficiency you found during your work overhauling the electrical system? You talked about efficiency as a goal. What's kind of like the low-hanging fruit of inefficiency that we could be dealing with?
Well, there are two big chunks. One is, we do know it create, you know, there's a loss of energy across transmission, right? And so not taking advantage of what we can do with distributed energy means that, you know, we're definitely losing a lot of, you know, inefficiency that way. But the other piece is that the grid itself is highly inefficient. People use planning models. That's one of the issues we're looking to work on at Tapestry. And so thinking about how you can use technology better to optimize the efficiency of the current system, I think is really important. I know the folks here from Smart Wires, I've got it right. But there's lots of companies that. So I think the other aspect of the grid that needs to change is we do need to digitize it. We do need to make it more efficient. We need, and that we should save, we should sort of, that's the other problem we need to work on first. But that, the systemic problem there is, utilities make money about deployment of capital, not productivity of capital. And so we need to change the regulatory models so that utilities will actually adopt these technologies. And also, the other big piece is, I think this industry, traditionally has been very slow as a technology adopter for good reasons, but we've run out of those good reasons. So we need to really think about how we can allow for an industry, which should be conservative because it's critical, to be much quicker in adopting new tech.
Yeah.
And be willing
or even tech that's already adopted, you know, like if you go to California, we're building gigawatts of batteries and they're a regular part of the daily grid. And then you go to, you know, North Carolina, not really many big batteries. It's sort of considered a, that's a new and emerging thing, so.
Well, that's one of the things that I think that we can think about how do we look for this and create standardization and make it easier. So most entrepreneurs will tell you they end up in pilot hell. And we need to get out of that and start looking at speed and scale. So that's where Durr's totally right.
Yeah, gotcha. Okay, there's a question of what gives you hope that the global community can curb the worst impacts of climate change? I might spin that a little bit. Are you hopeful that the global community can curb the worst impacts of climate change? And if so, why?
So this is one of the things that you and I, of course, we have, you're part of RMI. And RMI has part of its saying is around hope and tension.
Yeah, it was applied hope.
Applied hope.
Applied hope.
Yeah.
That's the...
So don't test us, right?
Yeah, no, they've got a lot of catchphrases. Yeah.
Anyway, point is being this, you know, I think that with the IRA being passed last year, which was amazing, because everyone in the industry thought...
This year.
This is this year.
What a year.
They thought it was dead. It was this year. It's not that old. And I think that it helped breathe life back into the U.S. Around this can really happen. But what I think is fascinating is when I was at the RMI, which is doing work globally, 60% of their work is in the global south now, which is amazing. But it just tells me you've got, that is where the growth of the future is. And the populations in Africa and Indonesia recognize that they need to go to the next level. And I think that's where all this momentum is going to be, can be created. So what I'm psyched about is I think we have gotten over the hump. Mm. I keep saying that, but I hope so. That whether we need to decarbonize, I think everyone understands that 2030 is tomorrow. 2050 is the day after tomorrow. And so this is all about speed and scale. And so it's all, and I think you got, you know, entering into the workforce at this point, what an amazing time to be able to say, look, I'm there and I help make it happen, not just like a project, but globally. So
yeah.
That's what I'm excited about. I think the conversation at this COP is all about, well, how do we make sure, right?
Yeah.
That this happens quickly.
And that's basically all of your professional lives is good, you know,
that's right.
The time it takes to get to 2050 and get to net zero. So big work ahead of you. But I had a lot of fun with this. I appreciate your depth of knowledge and kind of dry sense of humor in navigating some otherwise dense and wonky topics. So can we give Audrey a round of applause? Thank you. Thank you so much. All right.